All right, so we're gonna do kind of a couple part video, depending on how much time I have. Bellator 48 is going to be the first call today. I'm also gonna talk about MMA math and the theory of pride being crap. All right, Bellator 48, let's start off with that. Just the four main fights. Juan Barrantes versus Rene Nazare, taking Nazare by unanimous decision. The reasoning being is that Nazare is a submission fighter and a pretty good one, but Barrantes yet to be submitted in his MMA career. And he's fought some decent guys in that regard. Mariano Fernandez is a pretty good one. James Azzaburdo is a pretty good one. And I'm taking a unanimous decision here. Barrantes is really more or less just a can. I mean, 7-5. Every time he's made a step up against someone that I really, know of, he's lost. I've seen him fight twice against Miles Merola and once and Antonio Carvalho. And he got knocked out in both fights, basically. And was not overly impressive. Rico Rodriguez, Seth Petruzzelli. Rico looking better these days. Definitely not in his prime. The deal is, though, Seth Petruzzelli, not much of a takedown defense. We've seen that in his UFC fights. We saw that before he was in the UFC. Not much of a ground game to speak of. I see Rico, he's going to have a chance to knock out Rico, but he's going to come out. I think Rico's going to be able to take him down. Rico's going to be able to submit him probably in the second round, after he tires him out a bit. Cole Conrad, Paul Buentello. Cole Conrad by unanimous decision. Pretty much the lock-on Cole Conrad, result in Bellator. I don't think he's progressed to the point where he can finish a good veteran like Buentello. That being said, we know Buentello's wrestling is not anywhere near the caliber of Cole Conrad's, and he will pretty much get taken down at will. Then the tournament files, Pat Curran, Marlon Sandro. This is the interesting fight of the night. On one hand, you have Curran. He's a little more fast, a little more agile, a little more explosive than Marlon Sandro. Marlon Sandro, I think, has the technical edge on a lot of things, though. I think his boxing is more technically sound. I've always said that he has very sound technical boxing. It's just that it doesn't seem to have that explosive snap to it, and it doesn't seem to have a terrible amount of speed to it. That being said, it works. He guards his face well. He doesn't get, hit unnecessarily, and he does hit you, and he hits you with a reasonable amount of power, it seems. Curran, he tends to leave himself open a little bit. I think that's key. I think that when it comes to it, when he does get someone in trouble, he seems to let them clinch with him way too much. I think that this is also a fight where the opponent is somewhere near the same size as Curran, which Ronnie Mann wasn't, for example. That was the last fight Curran had. I see Curran looking good early on, but I see in the end Sandro being the more sound fighter and being able to pick up a unanimous decision here. Get on top, control, do his thing. It's not terribly the most exciting fighting style in the world, but it works. And I do kind of look forward to seeing if Sandro can make a run into the UFC, because I think he could energize that 145-pound division, which right now is pretty dead. Chad Mendez versus Jose Aldo for a title, anyone? Oh boy. Okay, so that's it for Bellator 48. Just a quick note on MMA math. Myself, Byron, and Brent up late decided to just screw around, and Daniel, and prove that Jason Guida is greater than everything. That amused us. He is now what we like to call MMA pie. If you can trace yourself back to Jason Guida, you're greater than Fedor and all current UFC champions. Go figure. So, yeah, MMA math useless. I've been saying that for quite some time. That being said, I mean, it's useful for comparing similar stylistic matchups, and that's really about it. That's all I have to say. Now I'm going to talk about Pride a little bit, and it's something that's always kind of bugged me, is that it seems like Pride champions are not allowed to get old. It's always that question of, were they ever any good? Why did they come to the UFC and look like crap? But, I mean, the problem is, some came to the UFC and looked really good, and those were the younger ones, the ones that weren't that old. Anyways, I'm going to delve into a bit of an explanation here. I've explained it a couple of times, but I think this is the first time I've ever brought it up in a video. That is, okay, Pride went under officially October 4th, 2007. It really had gone under before that. Let's see if the Wikipedia page actually has a list of the last event. No, it does not. Oh, wait, list of Pride events, just a second. Yeah, it's last event was it was April 8th, 2007. But we'll use the October 7th. That's when it officially ended its struggle for existence. And it's not like people got terribly older during that time. But anyways, the UFC champions at that time were Randy Natural Couture, Rampage Jackson, Anderson Silva, Matt Serra, and Sean Sherk. Now, people will say, well, the Pride champions came over and didn't look all that great. They all got their title shots, and except for Fedor, who didn't come over. And Gomi never got a title shot, but provably didn't deserve one. I mean, the Clay Guida fight, the Kenny Florian fight, I mean, that killed that idea. But here's the deal. How many of those UFC champions, with the exception of basically Anderson Silva, former Pride guy, have their titles still? And the answer is none. And where are they now? Well, Randy Couture is retired. Most of the top contenders for his belt are also pretty much gone, because this is right after he beat Gabriel Gonzaga. Gonzaga's gone. So where's this high-quality UFC fighter in the heavyweight division that existed at the time? I mean, basically, your only hope is Frank Mir. That's the only one that's relevant at this point. At 205, you have Chuck Liddell, who's, of course, retired, had just lost his title. Keith Jardine was amongst the top contenders at that time. He's gone. Vanderlei Silva came in and actually was a top contender because he beat Keith Jardine and then had a good fight with Chuck, and then Shogun beat Chuck. Rich Franklin, of course, was a top contender at 185, along with the now departed Nate Marquardt. Pretty much both are gone. Yeah, this was right before the Rich Franklin rematch. That was at the first event after the Pride purchase. And Sean Sherk is pretty much also nowhere, and the top contenders for his crown, BJ Penn doesn't seem to know where he's going. Jens Pulver was kind of in the mix just for name value, but that was it. Kenny Florian's gone down a weight class. So here's my, you know, throw it here to people who have continuously brought up Pride's no good, Pride's no good. Where are the UFC fighters that were the elite at that time? Because they're all pretty much washed up has-beens. Why are they allowed to get old, but the Pride fighters who fought many more times a year in more savage conditions and more bodily damaging conditions, they're not allowed to get old? I don't understand that. Additionally, a couple of Pride fighters have come over and done very well. Rampage, not that I consider him to really be a Pride fighter, but Anderson Silva, Dan Henderson did pretty well in the UFC and is doing very well outside of the UFC. Those are the three guys that kind of immediately come to mind. Keep in mind, of course, you have Shogun, who, if it isn't for the fact that he's blown out his knee, would be in the title mix. I mean, he just had the title, beat Machida, beat Chuck Liddell. Again, that's no joke. Lost to John Jones, who at the moment looks like an unstoppable force of nature. A lot of it ends up getting... And of course, here's the deal, obviously, is that people will bring up Big Nog as a way to discredit Fedor. Big Nog came into the UFC shortly after the Pride purchase. Looked terrible against another former Pride fighter, Heath Herring, but then won the title against Tim Sylvia. Granted, looked terrible against Frank Mir, but then decimated Randy Couture. And, you know, people are like, well, Randy got old and so on. You know what? Randy didn't look nearly as old towards the end as, like, half the Pride fighters did. Like, when they went out there and they moved, like, they were decrepit old men. And that's all I have to say on that. Anyways, throw down your thoughts in the comment bar. I would like to get some feedback on this. And enjoy the Bellator fights.